Hi, I'm Tim, an astrophotographer based in Sweden. If you're new here, welcome to my channel Cosmic Captures, where I share my astrophotography journey. And if you're returning, welcome back. This is the second episode in my mini-series Comet Chronicles, where I share my experience with Comet C2023 A3 Tsuchinshan-ATLAS. In this video, I will show you how I photographed the comet. You will learn something about comets. I'll show you the gear that I've used for this project, and I'll explain the main editing steps that brought me to the final result. So join me during a bright and windy night with an almost full moon as I travel with a much more lightweight setup to reach the perfect location. Yeah, it's beautiful out here, and I really love it when we have a full moon, because then filming like this is so much easier. It's like a giant spotlight in the sky. I'm at a different location south of Malmö. Yeah, there's some fishing huts and boats around me, and I just checked on YouTube today. It's the 16th of October. And it seems like the whole world is photographing that comet right now. A bright comet that you can see with your naked eye is a rare and very exciting event, not just for us astrophotographers. And for me, it's not only about taking pretty pictures. I also love to learn more about the space objects that I capture. Whenever I look at a comet, I feel a sense of wonder. It's almost like being a kid again. They remind me of fireworks, and the comet's tail looks like a rocket engine. But that's not how comets work at all. Because in reality, a comet is more like a dirty snowball made up of ice, rocks, dust, and frozen gases. Comets are frequent visitors from the outer solar system, either the Kuiper Belt, which lies just beyond the orbit of Neptune, or the Oort Cloud, a giant sphere of ice-like objects far, far away from the Sun. As a comet gets closer to the Sun, its icy center, called the nucleus, starts to heat up. This releases gas and dust, which form a glowing cloud called the coma. And now the solar wind and radiation pushes this material outwards, away from the Sun, creating the comet's tails. Before I photographed Comet Chuchinshan-ATLAS, I always thought comets had two tails. The dust tail, which reflects sunlight and often looks curved, and then the iron tail, which glows due to charged particles that interact with the Sun's ultraviolet radiation. But Comet Chuchinshan-ATLAS had a third tail called the anti-tail. It's an optical illusion because it's a matter of perspective. Depending on how the Sun, the comet, and Earth are aligned, it looks like there's a tail pointing towards the Sun. In reality, it's dust particles that the comet leaves behind on its orbit. For me, it's features like these that make comets such fascinating objects. Tonight, I also try something different because the camera is on a tracker. I'm still photographing with quite low, a short shutter speed of 5 seconds. But luckily, due to the tracker, I don't get trailing of the stars. And I really hope that the images will come out much better. Okay, let's talk about the gear that I've used that evening. For the camera, I used a Sony Alpha 7R Mark IV, and the lens was a Voigtländer Apollantar with 50mm f2. I use that lens wide open all the time for astrophotography because it has this amazing ability to create pinpoint sharp round stars even in the corners of a full frame sensor. And the color correction, because it's an apochromatic lens, is also fantastic. But one of my most appreciated features of this lens is that it has a mechanical focusing ring. So there's no focusing by wire where you not exactly know where it is. This is so much nicer to work with, especially in the dark, when you really want to accurately focus on a star. Yeah, what else? I used the camera with an ISO of 200, and the individual exposures that I took of the comet and the sky and the stars were 5 seconds long. Now, I know that a lot of people use the so-called 500 rule to determine how long their exposures can be before they see trailing or elongated stars in their images. And the 500 rule works like this, that you divide 500 by your focal length. In my case, that's 500 divided by 50. And I end up with 10, and that's 10 seconds I could theoretically go before I see star trailing. But this couldn't be further from the truth, especially with modern camera sensors like the A7R Mark IV with a 60 megapixel sensor. You will see star trailing so much sooner. So the question is, how can we accurately calculate how long our exposures can be? And for that, I use an app called PhotoPills. When you open the app PhotoPills and you are on the homepage and scroll down a little bit, then on the right-hand side, there's a tool called Spot Stars. And if I click on that, there's a second rule that we should use, and it's called the NPF rule. And according to the NPF rule, which takes the megapixels of my camera into account, I can go for 4.15 seconds before I see star trails. But there's another thing. Here, if I click on default, there's another setting that I can pick, which is called accurate. And if I want to make sure that I absolutely get pinpoint stars that would hold up in even a large print, then I should use that setting. And if I click on that, my NPF rule value goes down to 2.08 seconds. So I can just use 2 second long exposures if I want to make sure that my stars still remain round in my exposures. I went for 5 seconds. So what else can I do to ensure that I have pinpoint stars? And the answer is simple. You use your camera and your lens on a star tracker. And the star tracker compensates for the rotation of the Earth. Before I talk more about the star tracker, I need to insert a disclaimer. A few months ago, the company Move Should Move reached out to me and asked me if I wanted to test their Nomad star tracker. And since I had seen so many positive reviews on the tracker and was fascinated by its compact size and low weight, I said yes. And the deal is as following. Move Should Move sent me a package with the tracker and a few other accessories that I get to keep. And in return, I feature the tracker in one of my videos and show what it can do. Now, the disclaimer out of the way, let's see what this thing actually does. For this tracker to work, it needs to be aligned with the rotation axis of the Earth. And this process is also called polar alignment. Now, if you are in the northern hemisphere like I am, this is a very simple thing, because all you need to do is to point the rotation axis of your tracker to Polaris, also called the North Star. And with the green laser from Move Should Move, that whole process is super simple. But Move Should Move also offer a polar scope or a smartphone bracket to work with their tracker. And that's it. That's all there is to this tracker, because there's no need to connect your phone to an app and to the tracker, no need to attach anything else complicated to it. You do your polar alignment, you switch on the tracker, and everything just works. But my favorite feature of this tracker is its compact size and low weight. They deliver the tracker in this cute little pouch, which I don't find very practical because I don't like to assemble my gear when I'm out in the dark. Instead, I like to build my setup as much as possible at home and then find a bag or a solution that works for that. And I had this bag laying around in one of my closets, and this is the setup that I use for this star tracker. On the base, that's a move shoot move polar wedge, which helps me to do a more precise polar alignment. Then I have the actual tracker, and I have a V mount, and it helps me to get a more leveled base to work from. And when I'm out in the field, all I need to do is to put that on a tripod, and it can be a compact tripod like this one, and then add the camera on top of that. This is an insanely compact and lightweight yet powerful little setup, and I will continue using it. And now, finally, to the editing of the material that I captured that evening. As in the previous episode of Comet Chronicles, I'm not going to do this as a tutorial where I explain step by step how to do different things. Instead, I will explain my thought process behind the editing of this image, and you will also see the main editing steps that get me to the final result. So without further ado, let's dive in. What you see here is a foreground image that I took off the boat. It's a 5-second exposure with ISO 200, and you can see how incredibly bright that scene is because we had an almost full moon that night. I took a bunch of these, then moved my tracker and started shooting just the sky and the comet. In total, I think I took around 100 frames with 5 seconds each, but I only used 36 of them and moved them into my favorite stacking software, AstroPixel Processor, where I stacked them. I then took the resulting image into PixInsight, where I separated the comet from the stars. So I have two different elements I can work with, I can blend individually and mix with my foreground image. If you want to understand a little bit more about these steps, then please watch the previous episode of Comet Chronicles where I explain a little bit more in depth what I've did there. Yeah, now we can look at the images that I've got. The starless comet image looks like this. And the stars, they're just like pinpricks of light that have been removed from the comet image. It looks black, but I can change the blend mode to screen, and then I get a nice blend of the comet and the stars. Now, of course, we have this big issue that, first of all, of course, the boat sits now in the background behind the sky, and we need to fix that. But then there's also a gap between the bottom of my sky image and the horizon line of the sea in my foreground image. And what I did in Photoshop, I've used one of their relatively new AI features and extended the bottom part of the sky image, and I got this. And I thought, yeah, okay, this is something I can work with. I mean, those clouds on the horizon, they are not that important, but they looked like they would fit well. But now, of course, I need to bring the boat into the foreground. And when I did that, the result looked like this. Of course, I had to mask the boat, but if I disable the layer mask, then you can clearly see, yeah, that was the original image that we looked at a little bit earlier. next step was then simply some fine-tuning. I worked with the curves, I worked with some of the colors. There's this darker area here in the top part of the image, which I didn't like, and I boosted the colors a little bit, and the result is this. Then I looked at some of the details, like for instance here, when I zoom in, here in the bushes, I get some red lights, and that is because there's a huge wind park out in the sea behind those bushes. So I wanted to remove these. Then there's some funky colors going on here on the edge of the mask. I didn't like that. Then also here on the right hand side, these lights in the background, I don't think they add anything. I wanted them to go. And one thing I also noticed was that the horizon was a little bit off, slightly crooked. And I fixed that in the final editing stage. And this is the resulting image. So if I now look at the background, no strange coloration going on here. Everything looks good. I can have a closer look at the comet as well. And I really like that you can still see the anti-tail a little bit here in the front of the comet. I think when I look at this image, I think everything looks balanced, everything looks good. I like there's something going on in the sky. It's not just plain blue. I like those clouds actually, because I think they add atmosphere to the image. The foreground looks interesting. The comet looks really nice and it's bright enough. Of course, it's smaller than it would have been with an 85 millimeter lens, but I think it still works well. So overall, I'm very pleased with this image. But of course, this is just my opinion. I would love to hear what you think about this image. And also, if you have any other questions or have suggestions or ideas of how I can improve these videos, please write them in the comment section below. I think this is the best way you can help me and the channel right now, by liking the video, by sharing the video, by interacting, leaving a comment, things like that. Again, this video has been very labor intensive, and therefore I hope it has helped you, it has answered some of your questions, it gave you some inspiration on how to perhaps take nightscape images in the future. Yeah, that was it. Thank you so much for watching. I hope I'll see you in the next episode. And until then, I wish you clear skies.